Today, what are you wearing?
Dior.
And the shoes?
Of course.
Do you buy a lot of Dior?
Well, it depends. It's never enough, anyway.
It's the biggest event of Paris Fashion Week.
Dior show, we are waiting something special because a new designer, and we will see.
For the first time in its 70-year history, Dior's collection is designed by a woman. Newly appointed creative director, Maria Grazia Chiuri.
What are you trying to say about women today in this world?
I think that we have to start again to speak about equality.
She's at the center of a billion-dollar brand, spanning clothes, makeup, handbags and perfume.
It's quite impossible to register the formula of the perfume, so the only way is the secret.
We have privileged access to Dior as the Italian designer puts her first collection together in a matter of weeks.
Is it nerve-wracking at this point?
I have to maintain calm.
Inside, though?
It's a secret. My secret.
Join us inside this exclusive world as we discover the fabulous frocks, the psyches of the rich, and the courting of celebrities behind one of the world's most famous names. In mid-July, Maria Grazia Chiuri's appointment was announced by Dior fashion boss Sidney Toledano. Now, on her shoulders alone, rest Dior's reputation and its profitability.
On s'est vu la première fois, ça fait 17 ans. Je cherchais une styliste pour les sacs à l'époque. Et elle m'a dit, moi, les sacs seulement, ça m'intéresse pas. Et je lui ai dit, non, c'est les sacs ou rien. Elle m'a dit, c'est rien. Et aujourd'hui, elle a tout.
She has to hit the ground running to conceive, design and oversee the making of an entire collection that will be revealed in Paris Fashion Week in September.
I think that's the difference probably about my vision. I think it's very important that the girl maintain their personality.
And your friend here with the buns, this is an inspiration.
Why not? You don't know where comes the inspiration. The inspirations come about everything, about the life, and that's important.
He has a bun too.
You, of course.
Maria Grazia has come from rival fashion brand Valentino in her native Rome, where she and her design partner nearly doubled profits with their romantic dresses and hugely successful accessories, like the cult rock stud shoes.
Maria Grazia and Pier Paolo, together they were one of the greatest success stories of the current era of fashion. Under their leadership, Valentino went from being a successful, very successful brand into a £1 billion brand. From the point of view of being an editor, just everybody wanted to wear those clothes. So if you're shooting a celebrity on a front cover, they were all going to want to wear Valentino because they all look beautiful in these dresses. They really knew how to dress women.
Maria Grazia has inherited a highly skilled team. She briefs Dior's influential makeup director, Peter Phillips, and Guido, fashion's favorite hairdresser, with her vision.
We want to speak about the women in different ways, so we believe it's important to give a young attitude.
And I saw the girls, they look more boyish.
Yeah.
Which is
absolutely.
Really. Yeah.
Her mood board reflects the ideas for the new collection. Her inspiration includes fencing and feminism, star signs and superstition. The outfits are beginning to come into shape.
The idea about my first collection is that Dior is not only closer with Mr. Dior, but also with the other designer. Like, and so I use some elements that are come to all the Dior heritage, but with a different attitude.
Yeah, not completely. Cool,
if we want to help me, it would be great.
Yeah.
No, because it's not easy, Dior.
No.
After 7 decades, there's a deep heritage at the House of Dior. Maria Grazia is following in the footsteps not just of Christian Dior himself, but the famous names who have previously been chief designer here, including Yves Saint Laurent and John Galliano.
I think that Christian Dior stood so much for a kind of femininity that just doesn't exist anymore. I don't think we need a gentle world now. The world is tough out there. And for Maria Grazia to give to Dior a feeling of what a modern woman not only wants to wear, but has to do in the world, to go to work, to cope with her children, to cope with life, to go out in the evening, that's the kind of designer we're looking for today.
She's making clothes that will work beautifully on, you know, a young woman like Jennifer Lawrence, you know, one of the faces of Dior. But I think she will also make clothes that will look beautiful on older women. And you think the average age of a luxury brand consumer is 53. She will make clothes that a 53-year-old woman is going to look great in.
See you later.
See you later.
Thank you.
To me, Dior went out and looked for somebody who was an interesting modern designer, and that's who they found in Maria Grazia.
I work with many different designers, and each designer has their own approach. So the first cooperation is always a bit like searching how to communicate. But she's very open in her communication, and she illustrates her vision.
Peter Phillips has worked with them all, from Karl Lagerfeld to Alexander McQueen. But now he's working for the first time with Maria Grazia, on the look for her first show.
I mean, in this case, it's kind of a simple and easy brief. There are the sports elements which she brings into her collection. So I like to do maybe simple things by enhancing the eyebrows slightly, making it a bit more masculine. But at the same time, trying to keep the elegance of Dior. So it's very subtle. It's almost like an alabaster skin tone. And then if you turn, you can see that. I don't know if you read it. There's a bit of glow on the side of the face. I don't know if it captures it. I can use this. This is like a powdery effect. You see the shine? You see, you have this glow. Another one is, for example, a gel effect. You see, I get a bit more wet, but if you apply it thin, it becomes like a glow. And that's actually what I put on the side of her face here. It blends in with the skin texture. Underneath, I've got like a pure white, like a clown white almost, which I blend into the skin tone on the nose bridge and on the chin. So you kind of get those natural highlights enhanced. I just slightly enhance the eyebrow with a very thin eyebrow pencil. You can see them here. You can see the little stripes that I put in. It just enhances them without losing the naturality of the eyebrow. Kind of keep more like a bit of a tomboy look. It's very detailed, yeah. Quite often it's much more work to do makeup like this and do like a spectacular splash.
You have real skills.
Thank you. Yes, I hope so. Spread the word. No.
Alongside the makeup department, Guido, with his team of stylists, is coming up with hair designs to meet Maria's brief.
I'm doing a few different variations of the braid that she wanted in the back of her head. So this young lady has 4 braids, and there'll be 3, 2, 1. And the kind of where the knot is, how high it is, how messy it is, what texture of the hair it is, whether it's dry or a little shiny, and all those sort of nuances would be something that Maria Grazia will sort of pick up on. She's very instinctive.
It's a new adventure.
British milliner Stephen Jones has worked with the House of Dior for 20 years. But how will his relationship with the new creative director work?
Do you like wearing them? Have you tried them
on? Of course.
Maybe in the first fitting?
The first fitting, I spent all the time in this way because I was absolutely in love for this tape.
Maria Grazia, we're seeing your eyes through the netting. And if you look slightly up, you twinkle the eyes up.
I was completely in love. The first fitting, I spent all my time with this. Hat. Absolutely. Bye, have a good lunch.
The choice of Stephen's designs for the collection is still not finalised.
We were talking about fencing and the inspiration for the collection and what she would like to have, because she'd never really done hats before. We developed this idea, which is a little bit like a fencing collar, but actually worn on the head. And This is a little bit picking up the quilting from the front of the jacket with the ear flaps, but it actually it's like a visor. So we've done them in this quilt, and we did them transparently like that. And also we've done this version in metal, which we've been trying some on, but this is halfway through fitting, so I don't really know. I never ever think that it's done until the last girl comes off the runway. Christian Dior said, without hats, there is no civilization.
Did he?
Yeah.
What do you think of that remark?
I completely agree with him.
Vous êtes là depuis combien de temps?
Ah, 37 ans.
Vous, chez Dior?
Oui, moi, chez Dior.
Upstairs in Dior's ready-to-wear workroom, skilled hands are busy putting Maria Grazia's designs together. Known as the petites mains, or small hands, they've seen everyone come and go over the years.
Là, là, une époque nouvelle, donc on commence avec, on attend beaucoup de choses de Maria Grazia. Moi, j'ai jamais travaillé avec des femmes et je trouve que cette expérience est exceptionnelle. Et je suis contente qu'en fin de carrière, que je vois une femme.
Cette robe-là, par exemple, vous allez le porter?
Pourquoi pas? C'est pas ça, c'est faut avoir une occasion pour la porter.
Oui.
Si je suis invitée à une grande soirée VIP, pourquoi pas? Mais bon, maintenant, à mon âge, le décolleté, bon. Après, pour les jeunes, c'est super. Voilà.
Mais pour les messieurs, comme ce monsieur-là?
Eh bien, le monsieur, il ne va pas mettre une robe, je pense.
Non, pas pour cette occasion-là. Pour d'autres occasions, mais pas pour ça. Là.
Et je le vois bien avec une robe bustier, oui.
Qui sont assemblés ensemble et après posés. Et c'est posé en escargot comme ça.
Ça se démarre là, ça tourne comme ça.
C'est juste de là à là.
Ah, ah. Et vous pensez de la porter vous-même?
Je n'ai pas les soirées pour la porter.
Sûrement.
Et je n'ai pas la taille pour la porter non plus.
Vraiment? Il faut être très mince.
Et très grande. Et avoir l'occasion.
Ah bon.
Tall models will soon be wearing these clothes at the hotly awaited ready-to-wear show, which will launch Maria Grazia as Dior's new designer at Paris Fashion Week.
I like fairy tale. I love a fairy tale.
I want to test with the black pants, the look with the black pants.
With Paris Fashion Week approaching, Dior's new designer Maria Grazia Chiuri still has to take lots of decisions about her first big show.
I think it's too big
for. Which model will wear what, and with which accessories, footwear, and more important, underwear?
Scusate, però qui il reggiseno è avorietto, io voglio bianco. Grazie. Alla fine non ne potrei più. Ok.
As the fitting draws to a close, the studio is cleared of everyone but Maria Grazia, her closest assistants, and two models. A new designer at the House of Dior is enough to entice the most powerful person in fashion to pay a visit. Anna Wintour, editor-in-chief of American Vogue, has arrived for a special private preview. Her influence in the fashion world is legendary. Will she like what she sees?
Thank you.
reaction looks positive. Fashion brands and fashion magazines coexist in a multi-billion dollar industry, each dependent on the other for success. Every year, Dior spend countless millions on placing ads in the fashion press. But rather than headline-grabbing clothes, most consumers will buy handbags, shoes, cosmetics, and particularly perfume.
2084. Gold is cold.
In just 3 months in 2016, Dior's perfume and cosmetic sales leapt by 9% to 1.2 billion euros.
Feel what's real. That's it. Chanel. Dior.
Monsieur Dior understood that a bottle of perfume or lipstick is all most people can afford. So to capitalize on the largest possible number of clients, in 1947, he created his first scent, Miss Dior. It's still a bestseller. As Christian Dior himself realized, once you've created the brand, you can sell the dream. Near Grasse in the south of France, Dior still control the same fields of rose and jasmine used in making some of their perfumes.
Our flowers, it's exceptional. But these flowers is very, very expensive.
Carol Biancelana is the fourth generation of the same family to own these fields.
It's a manual picking because we must take only completely open flowers. We must pick at a good time in the day. It's now on the morning, 8 until maximum 12 o'clock for the best, the exceptional perfume.
Have you ever been seduced by a man offering you a particular perfume as a gift?
I don't want a gift for perfume because it's personal choice. It's so difficult to give a gift like perfume. A book, it's easy, not a perfume. A perfume is your personality. It's difficult to make a choice for a person.
C'est pas mal comme boulot, ça.
Oui.
Vous pensez?
Oui. Oui, on est bien. On est dehors, c'est joli, ça sent bon. Il fait beau.
It's a family concern. And when it comes round to the jasmine harvest, it's all hands to the bushes.
C'est mon papa.
Ah bon?
Mon papa avec le t-shirt bleu?
Oui. Oui. Maintenant, vous êtes son patron?
Voilà, maintenant c'est moi le chef. Voilà, pendant longtemps j'ai obéi à mon papa. Maintenant c'est lui qui m'obéit.
Elle est exigeante comme patron, votre fille.
Elle aime le travail bien fait.
Et vous êtes content que votre fille a continué?
Ah, absolument. C'est un patrimoine, la plante à parfum Grasse. Il ne faut pas l'oublier. Hein. C'est un patrimoine très, très... Vous imaginez, il y a 3 ou 4 siècles d'histoire.
Do you, in your job, have to have a good nose?
Big one. Pardon, sorry.
A good one.
The biggest nose at Dior is François Demachy, the man in charge of creating their perfumes. He is the one who decides what quantity of which flower will work the magic. Many of the products are sourced from cheaper parts of the world, but for the jasmine from Grasse, it takes 1,400 hours of picking to gather the 7 million flowers needed to make just 1 kilogram of the jasmine essence which goes into some Dior perfumes. This lab is where the alchemy takes place.
Là, nous montons au laboratoire. We call it atelier.
Finding the right formula is like striking oil. And François Demachy has done so several times in his 10 years at Dior and before that at Chanel.
The perfume is very secret. That's why we have separate the two ateliers.
Why is it so secret?
It's secret because it's quite impossible to register the formula of the perfume. So the only way to defend ourselves is the secret. And so we are maybe a little paranoiac about the secret, but it's like that.
Under high security, the inner sanctum of this laboratory is where the deeply confidential work is done. And industrial espionage is an ever-present danger.
So that's a formula. A formula is like a recipe with some raw materials and the quantity.
Can we read that? Can you show us? Would it be revealing too much?
It's quite secret, you know. But
show us a little bit.
Bay rose, bergamot, cedarwood, lemon, coriander, gayak wood, etc., etc., and the quantity. And that's a perfume.
Are some more expensive than others?
Sure, some are really expensive. For instance, the jasmine from grass costs almost 100,000 euros by kilo. That means twice the gold.
Twice as expensive as gold?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
It's quite complicated to grow the jasmine. It needs a lot of care. And the yield is very low. It needs more than 700 kilos of flower to get 1 kilo of absolute. Absolute of jasmine is a product that we use. Voilà, we keep here the product, the raw materials that we need to make our formula, and we have here almost 700 products. Yeah, and here, voilà. Ah no, here it's closed because it's our secret product.
Ooh.
And we have to open it.
The lady with the key.
Some products are very fragile. Voilà.
Top secret.
Yes, top secret.
So this is like the Fort Knox of perfume. Mm.
Yes, no way. Wow.
So even you don't have the key, only Carmen. Is that right?
Only Carmen. You
would you say that aromas can be erotic?
Well, absolutely. Don't forget that we are mammals and we are very linked with the smell. The smells from others can send a lot of messages, like la peur, l'attraction. You know, in some moment, some erotic smell are very, very good smell. And sometimes you can't control yourself because you smell that. And it's like that. Yes, we are animals.
Back in Paris, preparations for Maria Grazia's big show continue.
Sì, assolutamente sì, assolutamente sì. Perfetto, perfetto.
One of Maria's most forthright critics has arrived to see her work. Her 20-year-old daughter, Rachele.
I spend a lot of time with my daughter too. She's my muse, of course. Also because fashion is about love, and the best love that I have is for my son and my daughter, of course.
Hello. Might your daughter influence your collection?
Absolutely, yes.
Rachele has Eurostarred in from her studies in history of art at London University. She's come to give her mum support and to share in the excitement.
Have you seen many of the photos?
I haven't seen much yet, actually. I'm very excited. But from what I can see, like...
No, select nothing amazing for yourself, huh?
No, oh. No, don't worry about that.
I know you.
Bellissimo.
Huh? So cool. Thank you, madame. Thank you. Look. It's so cool.
No, I want to show the soleil. Look, it's a pretty...
The sundress is one of 64 outfits that are almost ready for their Paris Fashion Week unveiling.
The soleil.
It looks amazing, yeah.
It's so fun. I like it, honestly. I really like it.
When you see your mother's collections,
yes.
Are you critical?
Always. I always tell the truth. Like, I'm not interested in lying to her. So if I don't like something, I just say it, to be honest.
That's very important. All the time I ask her, please give me your opinion. And honestly, I think that's helped me to have the right vision, because sometimes the please around you could please you. But she's also inspiring for me, because in her I see the new generation that has different approach, because she look everything with the fresh eyes. She has not the same reference that I have. So I think it give me open mind, because she said, honestly, I like, I don't like. Sometimes with the age, you think too much about the things. And that's not good sometimes. But Raquel, honestly, she's...
I don't need to lie, because I don't work for her.
Bonjour. Bonjour. Comment ça va? How are you?
It's the day before new Dior designer Maria Grazia's first show. She's having a final inspection of the location. It costs upwards of 20,000 euros a day to hire the famous Rodin Museum. But Dior will only be using it as a grand entrance to the main event. They've built their own massive theatre in the gardens behind. The hugely sought-after embossed invitations have gone out, and 1,000 guests are expected to fill the space.
These are the shoes for the new collection.
And it's all got to be kept pristine. Even Maria Grazia herself cannot sully the perfect patina of the Dior grey painted floor.
This is a house light, the pre-show.
Not so white.
No, exactly, which you can see, it's quite warm. No?
I
mean,
it's quite warm.
Stripped to its simple essence, with pine blocks as benches and pine boards for runways, it probably doesn't matter that the benches aren't padded for those thin fashion editor bottoms. This whole enormous investment is all for a show that will last a total of 10 minutes. The set is modelled on the fencing room in one of Maria Grazia's favourite films, Visconti's The Innocent. Mother and daughter are relaxed enough for Rachele to tease Maria Grazia that her first show might be her last.
Fantastico.
Dice, come potevo non essere, capito?
Mamma, quella è italiana, quella raggio. Sì, RTL 102.5. E lui che eri? Lui che mi ha dato l'iPhone.
Ah, carino.
Maria Grazia,
The only few moments of peace are in the intimacy of the short drive back to the studio.
Sono contenta che abbiamo fatto questa scelta del museo. Il film, sembra proprio quel setup. No, molto contenta.
Bien sûr.
E anche dover lavorare con tutta gente che non si conosce, devo dire la verità.
Non è facile, soprattutto all'inizio.
Però devo dirti che a me la cosa che un po' mi manca è il sonno. Cioè, per me andare a letto alle 2, svegliarmi alle 7, alle 8.
Vabbè, tanto ma la prossima settimana dormi.
Cioè, non è così semplice. Comunque dai, è andata.
È andata.
With her big show only one day away, Maria Grazia goes straight back to the studio.
Questa è praticamente la nuova bar, come diceva Monsieur Dior, la moda è evoluzione e rivoluzione.
She has another visit from an influential magazine editor. Stefano Tonchi, editor-in-chief of American fashion magazine W, has known Maria Grazia since their student days together in Florence.
Maria Grazia, she had a dark look, what we used to say, you know, a little bit like goth, a little bit crazy.
We were both kids in Florence in the early 80s. We were fashion animals. So you would go from New Romantic to Bohemians, then to reggae kind of stuff, like a culture club. This, I think, is a great opportunity, and I'm happy that she took it.
No, questa cosa di donne lo so che è centrale a tutto.
Ha messo
il,
tutto a senso, molto, cioè, centrale.
So, perché il problema della moda femminista è che è sempre stata brutta. Un po' perché nessuno può parlare al mondo come gli stilisti.
So I go back to the moral responsibility of fashion and fashion designers. I think that's something that I really think you have the power, you have the influence, you can talk to people.
What do you think, Maria Grazia?
I think that anything that you do has a huge audience impact that you are responsible.
What do you do about the issue of too many skinny girls, the whole issue?
Honestly, sometimes the people forget that in any case we work in fashion, and the word mannequin is a specific thing. It's because some girls are skinny because they are really skinny in a natural way, others no. It's more important to be strong than to be skinny, probably.
Skinny,
that you have to, that you have to be fit more in a gym, that you can change the message and you can have a positive message. There is not only one story.
As Maria Grazia puts the finishing touches to tomorrow's big show, another branch of the Dior empire, jewelry, prepares to open an expensive new store. While all those rich clients are in town, jewelry director Victoire de Castellane hopes they'll take a shine to one of her shiny baubles.
Is it important in selling jewelry for clients to see the pieces themselves in a way?
Of course. But we have clients who are just buying without seeing the jewelry.
Really?
Yes.
Does that surprise you?
I think that's a very eccentric way to buy, and I think that's a very good way to buy. It means that people are... What can I say? C'est une façon d'acheter très libre.
Oui.
Et c'est bien.
Pour le commerce, c'est bon.
Oui, oui, mais je trouve aussi que c'est très... j'aime cette extravagance.
Ah.
Oui, parce que la joaillerie a besoin d'extravagance.
It certainly does in this shop, where some of the pieces cost over €1 million. At their industrial beauty complex, a couple of hours south of Paris, Dior make products that are a little more affordable. Here they churn out a never-ending stream of potions, lotions, and lipsticks.
I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't.
In the darkened basement of the beauty laboratories, they test more and more ways to profit from our apparently endless desire to look younger for longer.
Donc celle-ci, on peut mettre en évidence la microcirculation de la peau. Voilà, et ça c'est une photo qui a été prise en UV, qui on peut mettre en évidence du coup les spots, donc les taches sous-cutanées.
Ça met en avant nos défauts.
Qu'est-ce que vous pensez, madame, quand vous voyez ça?
Je m'inquiète pour l'avenir.
Voilà.
Ça va mieux.
C'est mieux comme ça.
La normale est mieux.
Paris Fashion Week. The day has arrived for Maria Grazia to reveal her first Dior collection. She has had only 10 weeks to prepare for it. The world's fashion media are fascinated to see if she can pull it off.
I see my daughter. She is obsessed about the looks.
Yes.
She changed herself also honestly in the same day.
Yes, 3-4. My daughter, 10, she's the same.
She's
obsessed. She puts things
together
herself.
So you have to give them different things.
Another hugely influential fashion figure, especially in the vital new markets of the East, Angelica Chung, editor of Vogue China, gets a sneak peek.
We are speaking about equality,
yes,
the same opportunity, yes, for men and women, because I have a boy and girl. I want that they have the same opportunity.
But with some humor, that shows humor, more confidence. Yes. I can see there's a more whimsical feeling about it.
British model Ruth Bell is opening the show. There's one big difference between her and the other models in the lineup.
Ruth, we're just talking about you, the only girl with no braids.
Why? I want braids.
But if you try, I mean, there's nowhere to put a little braid in this.
Don't mess it up. Last season I had no hair, so I would never ever go into hair. And this is my first show this season with hair, so I have to actually go and get something done to it.
You had a shaved head?
I did. Completely shaved.
And how did that work professionally?
Amazingly, yeah. It's kind of the reason why I'm here. Let's be real.
That you have a shaved head?
Yeah, yeah.
You want a break?
I came with
hair. Hey, look who's behind you.
Found you!
The other big difference about Ruth is that she has an identical twin. May is also modelling today.
How did you get into this business? How long have you been in it?
We went to Paris for a holiday about 5 years ago and somebody came up to us. We didn't believe him. We thought he was like a fake. My mum thought he was trying to sell us something, so hurried us away and he sort of dropped his card in our backpack. Yeah, without us knowing. And then like exactly a year later we found the card, emailed the guy, turns out it was totally legit. Like, really nice guy. And we were apologising profusely for being really rude to him.
How old were you?
15 when we got scouted, 16 when we got signed.
And can I ask the impolite question, how old are you now?
20. We don't look 20, but I promise you
we're 57. We just age really well.
Now, in this business, you're not young
anymore. No! Pretty much a retirement. It like hurts me every day. Yeah, I've never thought about it like that, but thanks for coming. Thanks for staring us, but our careers are nearly over.
As final preparations are being made backstage, out front the world media and the 1,000 VIP guests are in a fashionable frenzy of anticipation.
Just sweating because we want to enjoy the show by the new designer from Dior, and we are very excited to discover it. I believe it will be absolutely wonderful.
What makes you think that?
Just because I trust Dior to have chosen someone.
Outside the Rodin Museum, the rich, the thin, and the fashionably facelifted assemble for the hottest show of Fashion Week.
Where are you from?
From Moscow. Dior show, we are waiting. Something special, something nice.
Backstage, the models are ready for the show. Except one, who has only just arrived to have her hair done.
There was a girl that passed out at a previous show and now she's sick. And so she will not be joining us here and I have taken her outfit.
Runway veteran Julia Nobis has been drafted into the show at 2 hours' notice.
Going back home, I was about to have a shower and wash stuff out of my hair and then go off to my fittings, which I guess now will be rescheduled until after this.
The VIPs start to arrive. The lower ranks through the pack of paparazzi at the front gate. But the VVIPs are invited to enter through a side gate with high security and selected photographers. Kate Moss, of course. A Chinese star with her accompanying press pack. And avoiding photographers and with never less than 4 beefy bodyguards, the most important VIP of all, Dior's owner, France's richest man, Bernard Arnault, who is led straight to the back door. Rihanna. Natalie Portman. And backstage, the last-minute touches to Maria Grazia's creations, the 64 models flown in for the occasion.
So exciting to see all the clothes, all the girls. They transformed these beautiful young women.
And braidless Ruth has been chosen to lead the whole parade.
I just did Ruth.
Did you? What did you do?
Gave her like an 80s vibe, do you know what I mean? I did a little, like, I don't want to mess it up. It's like...
It took ages to...
In its, like, unconformity, it's conformed.
Everything is ready.
Is it nerve-wracking at this point?
I have to maintain calm.
Inside, though?
It's a secret. My secret.
The collection says a number of different things about the Dior woman today, because there wasn't just one look. There are the tarot card dresses. You know, Dior was a great magical thinker. He certainly believed in lucky numbers and lucky symbols. So I think she picks up on the power of magic.
How was it? Right.
There was the fencing section, which I suppose presents or suggests the idea of a woman being strong and being powerful, but also being deft and being swift. And then there was also the section that reimagines the Dior codes of tailoring, which include the tuxedo jacket, the bar jacket.
How was it?
It's good. Not finished yet.
No.
It's finale time.
And you didn't smile, did you?
No, of course not. You don't smile, it's fashion.
How does Maria Grazia's first show compare to Dior's first show with the new look? Of course, they're totally different. And if we were to see the new look today, would it look so new? No, because fashion is about reinvention. It is about change. Maria Grazia's first show does draw on the Dior legacy, the Dior history, the Dior language, whilst also looking very new.
Anna Wintour tries to make her usual quick getaway.
I thought the show was very feminine and very delicate, yes. So I'm very proud as an Italian girl. A girl and an Italian girl.
It's wonderful to have Marie here and to have a woman at Dior. It means so much to all of us.
What do you think about the feminist slogans on the T-shirt?
I love the feminist slogan, and I'm all for her revolution.
How many of your hats were used?
I think we used about 7 or 8. We added one just at the end, so
oh, did
I can't
you?
Remember.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Did you like his hats, can I ask?
I love his hats. I love everything about him. He's incredibly talented and a lovely person.
The fashion world is notoriously lavish in its praise. Today, even more than usual.
Reactions are so positive, I'm very happy.
Do you think those reactions are sincere?
I think so. I tell you, I have some experience now with the business. So they always tell you it's nice, it's fine. But you see during the show, I think I got a lot of positive reaction.
Within minutes, Maria Grazia is being proclaimed the newest star in the Dior firmament.
Wonderful. Fresh, new. With a lot of energy, I think that's what we really needed.
And protected by tight security, the ultimate boss, Monsieur Arnaud.
How was it?
It was wonderful. And she is so bright, and it was so Dior.
So it's a terrific success.
Can you tell whether it will be a commercial success?
That I am sure.
Fantastic.
No problem. We'll be out of stock very soon.
I'm happy because I did a good job for myself. That's important. I very feel well with my conscience because I'm very serious woman, and I think that the company like Dior gives a lot of job and many people, and so the people like me that are in this position has a huge responsibility, especially in this time.
It's 70 years since Christian Dior changed the face of fashion, creating an empire from his South of France retreat. His blueprint for a brand, using headlines of fashion to sell a range of luxury goods and cosmetics, has been copied by many. Despite recession and economic upheaval, the public appetite for luxury continues to grow. The emperor may be dead, but his empire lives on.